Dear Lord, Father God, I ask you to bless this church and all that hear it. Father God, I ask you to have them remember your word and not remember me and not remember anything, but only remember you. For thou art our Father, our Savior. Father God, I ask you to bless the words that I'm speak will be your words and not my words. That somebody will be touched in the name of Jesus. Amen. Good morning, everybody. Good morning, everybody on the internet. God bless you this wonderful Sunday morning. Today we're going to talk about not giving up. Genesis 26, verses 12 to 32, for all those who want to read it later on, but that's the verses that we are working with. I was, you know, looking for a word, and I prayed, and I looked around me, and I noticed a lot of people were giving up. They just would start something, and they would stop, and they say it's not worth it. Then I thought about all the Christians that, or the people that go to church, and they go there for a week or so, or sometimes a month, or sometimes lower, less or more, and they find out it's not working out. And what do? They give up on God. I can remember there's a guy that's down the road from here, for those who may know it. He has a garage, and it's a fully stocked bar. They don't sell the alcohol, but when you drive by, it's a bar. And I asked him one time what happened, and I found out through some other people that he used to be a person that really believed in God, and he runs this bar on Sunday. And I think that's part of his fight, is because he's given up on God because his child died. He blamed God for his child. You know, sometimes when things don't work out, we just can't blame God. We have a tendency to want to blame somebody. And since God doesn't sometimes come there and defend himself, I didn't do that, we make it an easy target. Let's just blame God for everything that goes wrong. If you've seen it, I remember working with a patient one time. And it kind of irritated me, and I had to tell him it's not God's fault, because every time he did something, he said, the devil made me do it. I said, no, the devil didn't make you do it. You did it. You know, the devil or God didn't come down, hey, you need to hit that person, or you need to steal that. The devil didn't make you do it. You did it. You can't blame other people sometimes for your actions, because you have to take responsibility for your actions. The same thing with God. You ask God to come in your life, and then the next thing you know, we're out there cursing. We're doing all the things that God doesn't like, and we wonder why God's not in our life. Just imagine, if you would, if you came home and you brought all the top gangs in the world leaders into your house. I'm talking the worst of the worst. I'm talking cartels, everything. I don't think your parents would welcome you home. I don't think your parents would give you blessings to come by anytime you want. And then you can't understand why your parents aren't encouraging you to do things, because you're walking away from them. They still love you. But at the same time, you know, they gave up on you in a sense. They say, step away. You see, we're going to talk about giving up. Crab mentality. I love to fish. My son loves to fish. Everyone I know just about loves to fish. Either they love fishing or they like to eat fish. Somehow it's in that picture. What do these words mean? It's a way of thinking best described in a phrase, if I can't have it, neither can you. This metaphor refers to a bucket of crabs. The crabs in the story easily can escape from a bucket. If you take a bunch of crabs and put them in a small bucket with a small lid, theoretically, they could just leave if they wanted to. But instead, they grab onto each other in a useless king of the hill. They all go in a mound, and they're crawling around. Like, I was fishing the other day, and I had a bunch of fiddler crabs, and I didn't have a good-sized bucket, and I was kind of concerned they were going to get out. I was trying to lid on it, and I realized soon afterwards, no, they weren't getting out at all. And they were just like piling on top of each other. They gave up the fight to leave the bucket. You see, sometimes our behavior is that way. We give up the fight. I want to look at the story that we just read, that we read from the Bible right now. The lessons from the wells of Isaac. When Isaac sowed in that land, he reaped a year a hundredfold, and the Lord blessed him. You see, sometimes we do things, and things just work out great. You know, you go to a new job, you're making good money, and everything's good, and all the bills are good, and everything's good. Then all of a sudden, it hits you. The car breaks down. Somebody gets really sick. The car breaks down again. Like in one time it happened in our family, lightning hit the well. I don't know if you know this, but getting a well redug is really expensive. And then make matters worse, I wasn't really in country. Ask my wife. I was in Africa on a missions trip, and she had to deal with this by herself. I bet you she felt like giving up. You see, we can't just give up when the first problem comes across our face. The Bible tells us there's going to be many problems. So if you're out there sharing the word, you know, I tell everybody we share the word, and the first time you get one negative thing, you stop. Sometimes you say, I'm searching for God, and your friends may laugh, and you stop. It reminds me of a story that I heard. It's not a true story, but it's a good example. This man was told that he was going to go on an airplane, and he was given a parachute, and he says, listen, if this plane crashes, you're going to have this parachute, and you could jump out, and you'll be safe. So he gets in the airplane, he puts on the parachute, and it's really uncomfortable. He's squirming around in his seat. He's like, this is really messed up. He looks around, and the people are snickering at him, and they're laughing at him. They're like, what are you doing? Why are you wearing a parachute? What's the thing that he does? He takes that parachute, shoves it off, says, I'm never going to wear that thing again. I don't want that thing near me for 100 miles. I look stupid in it. People are laughing at me. Heck, I don't even know if we're going to crash. But you take the second man. That man was told, listen, when you get to 30,000 feet, at exactly 12:30, that plane is going to burst into flames. You're going to be in this seat, and it's going to eject. If you don't have that parachute, you will die. But if you have the parachute, you will float down. So that man is on that airplane. He grabs onto that parachute because he knows it's going to save his life. And then as he's holding on to it, the stewardess comes by and spills hot coffee on him. What does he do? He holds that parachute even harder, saying, I'm not worried about that hot coffee because I got this parachute, and this parachute going to save me. I don't care what goes on in this plane. I'm holding on to this parachute no matter what he holds on. The story means this. The first man, he was out there, and he didn't have a grasp of God. He said he believed in God, but his friends laughed at him. His friends did this, and he was more worried about how he would look in society and what people would think. He didn't realize or really read the Bible to understand the meaning, so he throws away God and he gives up. He says, why should I go to church? People are saying this. The government's saying this. Things are happening. I'll just join the flow. I don't see anything going on right now, and anyway, it always fixes itself. Now the other man knows about God. The other man knows no matter what happens, he's going to hold on to God because he knows one day, because the Bible says that there will become a day. But he doesn't know when exactly. Now, in the story, he knew, but in real life, we don't know when that day will come. And he's not going to let go of God no matter what happens. The story goes that the coffee spilled on him. Well, that's the story of our life. Things go wrong in our life, and we still don't let go of God. We may end up in jail. We may lose our house, lose our car, lose our job, but we do not let go of God because God will be there for us. When that day comes, we will have him next to us, and we're not going to let go. This is what I'm speaking about. We have to carry on. We can't give up because some adversity got in our life. You look at this story. It's great because here they're digging wells all around and everybody's chasing them out. It doesn't matter. All the wells are productive. And they say, hey, you got too much good. We don't want you here. Ever been to a job where you do a really good job and people don't want you there? You know you're doing a good job because the other people say, hey, man, that guy's too good. He makes us look too good. I remember watching the movie, and I love this. Football season, Super Bowl is coming up. Y'all remember the movie Rudy? Here was Rudy. He was the smallest guy, and it's a true story. He's the smallest guy on Notre Dame. I mean, he can't get smaller than that. They let him play. He played hard. And one day, they were practicing. You see, Rudy couldn't play in the actual game because he wasn't good enough. But he was on the scrub team, that the one that keeps the regular football team on par. And a guy, one of the team members, gets upset with Rudy and says, "What is wrong with him? He plays every day like it's the Super Bowl." And the coach says to him, "Well, if you played like every day it was the Super Bowl, we'd be winning every day." You see, he never gave up. He never let go. Now, Rudy had a lot of obstacles. He was told, I can remember watching the story about him, and he wanted to go to college. And Rudy really wanted to go to college. He wanted to play for Notre Dame, but he didn't have the grades. So he got on the bus. They said there was going to be a tour of the college. He said, "No, Rudy, you can't go. You're not smart enough." And they took him off the bus. And he did not give up. He ended up working, cleaning the field, and he went to a junior college, and one day he made it. Well, because of that, the rest of his family members went to college. They left the steel mills. Rudy became a public speaker, a motivational speaker with a college degree. He made it because why? He never gave up. See, God is with you. He will never give up. And here was these wells being dug. He never gave up. He never stopped, even though he was doing the right thing. I can remember I was told one time when I was working, I worked at Gloria Jean's coffee shop when I got out of the military for a little while. And I was bored, but I had been in the military and I had learned something in the military. Look busy. Doesn't matter what you do, find an easy job and look busy. Make sure it's easy because you can do a long job. And make sure it's a long job at that. So I remember looking at the floor where the coffee machines were, and it had a little tiles with white stuff. But it wasn't white. It was all brown from coffee. So I got this toothbrush when it wasn't busy, and I would just scrub it there. And I said, you know, it was habit. No, I'll scrub it. It's not hard. And I started getting it white, and it started looking good. So I said, oh, I can go further. And I just did it and did it and did it. I remember my boss came in one day, and he saw me, and I said, oh, man, he's going to get upset I'm not doing whatever, because I picked an easy job cleaning the floor. And he goes, how much do you make? And I remember I told him it was $5.05. He goes, no, it isn't. It's $5.25. You see, I didn't give up. I was in a tedious job, and I did not give up. You see, you can't give up on God. God's going to be there all the time. The thing is, we think that he should be answering all our questions, and we don't realize that he's answered out of them already. We just haven't heard the answer because we're thinking of ourselves. Why do we give up? It's simple. We give up on God because we did not get what we wanted. Think about it. Everyone that's given up on God, You gave up because you did not get what you wanted. It wasn't about God. You can say this, well, God, let my child die. Well, God, let me get fired. There's never one time I've ever heard, I gave up on God because he just wasn't a good God. No, I never heard that. I heard he did not do what I wanted him to do. Did you get rid of your parents because they didn't let you go out? You got mad, but you still love your parents. Did you get rid of your kids because he acted up? No, you punished them. You got upset. But boy, you would go to bat for them no matter what they do. You didn't give up on your child. I love my son. He's joining the Navy. He joined the Navy. I rephrase that. He's sworn the first time, and then he's going to become a sailor after boot camp. And there's something amazing about his story. And this is for all the ones that listen to the internet. I'm not going to have to say his name because he doesn't like to be publicized. But there's something he did. He never gave up. He was a little overweight. He worked hard. It didn't matter what anyone said. It didn't matter how many million diets out there. He did his research, and he said, I'm going to stick with it. Now, I thought he gave up, and then I found out later on when I did a little research myself, he had done this diet, and he stopped. Well, you need to once in a while because it will tear you up. But he was smarter than me on that respect. He knew what he was doing. He wasn't giving up. He just took a different path. At least not me. I didn't know it was the right path. But he took it and he stuck with it. And then when he weighed himself, he was 1 pound under the required. But when he got there, he told me, I was right at the mark. He made the goal. Why? Because he never gave up. Now, I want you to look at this story as a Christian. Here he is losing weight on Christmas, Thanksgiving, when there's a lot of food. Now, I'm going to tell you something. My son does love carbohydrates and all that stuff and chips. I've seen him eat them. I know you love chips, Eric. But you know what? He didn't eat them. He got tired of eggs. One day he told me, please, Dad, I want anything else but no eggs. I'm tired of eating eggs. Because, you see, he was not giving up. When he came home from the recruiter's office after he went up to Jacksonville, he didn't even tell me what his weight was. He said, I'll tell you when I get there. And I saw in the look in his eye, I saw success. He worked hard. He never gave up despite all the obstacles. In life, when we do stuff and God is with us, you can't give up. It doesn't matter if you go to prison, you don't give up. It doesn't matter if the bills don't get paid. It doesn't matter if things are wrong. God is in your life. God will direct your life. Can you give yourself to God? If God is not in your life, don't give up. Ask yourself, did you include God in your life? Are you doing things that God really says don't do and you can't understand? I watched this thing one time, and it certainly amazes me all the time about the cartels. Do you know there's a lot of, in Central America, there's a lot of Catholicism, a lot of Catholics, a lot. And some of these cartel members, their moms are devout Catholics. I mean, hardcore, you'll see them. They don't want to offend their mom. Their mom goes to the church. You know what they'll do? They'll take a cross and actually have it embedded in their skin, underneath there. So they'll have the cross with them so nothing will happen to them. Here's what I'm saying. How can you go against the word of God and expect him to save you? They're out there killing and robbing people, thinking just because they carry their cross, God is with them. God's watching them all right. God's waiting for them to change their mind and act right, but he's not going to help them in their endeavors. God's not going to help you to sin. So if you're out there today doing something that you know is really wrong, and this is on the internet, if you're cheating on your wife, God's not going to help you find a better place to go meet your girl. If you're stealing money, God's not going to go out there and put the police in a different spot so you can steal more money. If you're out there murdering somebody because of whatever, God's not going to assist you. You can pray all you want. It's like the football teams. That amazed me too. Super Bowl, both teams will pray. You'll see them. They'll pray and they'll say, God is with us. Wait a minute, it's just a game. I don't really think, I mean, I've heard people from the University of Florida say, you can tell God's a UF fan because the sky is blue and the grass is green, you know, stuff like this. No, God is for him. You can't ask God to fix things that don't glorify God. And if your actions don't glorify him, that's why he's not in your life. Now, if you're trying to glorify him, I'll give you an example. Our church ministry, we're trying to get this thing off the ground, to go to the Bahamas to help out people. We're trying. I know I make mistakes. I know we don't have a financial windfall. But yesterday, somebody talked to me. I'm not going to go into details. My wife doesn't even know about this. One of the gentlemen I have to counsel, he just married his wife, and then she committed suicide. He was the one that found her in Pennsylvania. He walked into the living room, and she was dead. And I'm really praying for him. He says, I got something for you. I said, man, how can you say you got something for me, and you're talking about your wife just killed herself? He says, but she wanted to give some money to help your church, but she wrote a check. And I want to get it in cash, and I want to give it to you. I want to honor her memory. You see, what I'm saying is, keep on going forward. God will bring things to you. Now, I don't know what it is. It could be $10. I don't mind. The thing is, he remembered God. And you see, God will be there for you no matter what. He will never forget you. I can remember one day, You know, I didn't give up. I had to pick up some food in Lakeland. They got this place in Lakeland where you can buy food. You got to be a church, but you got to spend like $200, $300 a month, something like that, to get food. You get this huge amount. Do not keep it in your garage. Me and my wife will tell you that. You know, you attract things you don't want to attract, like insects. And so I went there, and I'm like, okay, I got enough gas. Now, if I don't run the air conditioner in the U-Haul truck, I'll save gas. I say, if I keep the windows rolled all the way up, maybe I'll be more aerodynamic. I'm going through all these things, you know, how, because I know when I make it to Lakeland, that's not the problem. The problem's coming back from Lakeland. Plus, I'm hauling a bunch of food. I'm like, boy, I'm going to make it. But I'm going to go. I'm going to trust God. I'm not going to give up. So I'm in there, and I'm doing, you all have done this. You go to the gas station, you're like, 5 cents, six, ooh, there's a quarter. And, you know, you're counting it, and I'm putting all this, and this man comes up to me and says, you with the church? I look around, I go, yeah. I didn't know what to say. He goes, well, here's $40 for your fuel. He got back into his pickup truck and drove away. And I'm holding two $20 bills. Do you know want to know something? It was exactly what I needed. I was like, thank you, Lord. So I went and got a soda with the change, and I got and I put the money in the gas tank. I'll be honest with you. I got a soda. I don't drink the soda, but I said, oh, that's soda money. That's gas money, you know? And I made it there and made it back. And guess what? It was the right amount of money. By the way, a U-Haul, when you go 100-some miles, uses a lot of fuel. They're not economical. But anyway, I'm trying to say, I didn't give up. You can't give up no matter what your obstacle is there. As I get ready to close, here was he did not give up. He dug all these wells, and no matter what happened, finally the people came to him and said, we want to be friends with you. We see God has blessed you. You see, you do what is right because you know what's right, and it's right with God. You don't do it because you want to please God. You want to do it because you know God wants it. Yeah, you want to please God. That's a wrong word. You don't want to do it to make yourself look good in God's eyes. You just want to do it to please him, just because of who he is. He's like my dad. I want to do something just to make him smile. It doesn't matter what it is. I just want to make him happy, and I want to make my Father in God happy. So I'm not going to give up on him. I'm going to do the things he asks me, or try to do the things he asks me. I'm going to try my best, and I'm not going to give up. Don't give up on your life. Don't give up on your walk in Christ. The Bible says the road is narrow. He says the road is narrow. What's that mean? It's going to be a hard walk. But you know what? The best part of it, you're not alone. If you go through problems, it's better to have somebody with you. You can always celebrate by yourself and always have fake friends, but your true friends will walk with you through the trials. God will walk with you, and then you'll notice your other Christian friends walking with you too. And then you stop thinking of yourself, and you say, when they fall down, I'm going to pick you up. As I close, I want to give you one little thing that I learned. In the motorcycle community, they call it brotherhood. It's all about brotherhood. Now, they do a lot of gossip, and they do a lot of this and that, but it's brotherhood. Because when one falls down, everybody falls down. Last night, somebody was out with his friends, and he saw some people he didn't like. There was no fight or anything. He called up, and people came out of the woodwork and said, brother, I'll just sit with you to make sure everything's okay. And they went home with him to make sure everything was okay. When was the last time we did that for a fellow Christian? Think about it. When was the last time a fellow Christian, not even in your church, you know they're a Christian, you may have seen them in church, or you see that little fish sign on your car, and it says John 3:16, broken down on the side of the road. Now, you ever notice motorcyclists, when one stops, breaks down, they always stop. They may not have money. They may have anything. They'll say, hey, brother, and they'll say, hey, can I help you? What can I do? They're stopping. But we don't stop for fellow Christians that are having hurt. Now, I mean, don't do this. Don't say, I only will stop and help those that I know are Christians. Don't do it that way. Stop and help everybody. But we need to start not giving up on God. We need to start really following the rules. You see, when we do what God wants and we make him happy, our lives become happy. I want you to remember, don't give up on your life no matter what you do. Keep digging those wells. Don't stop for anything. The end goal is heaven. The end goal is to be with your Father. But most importantly, the end goal is to make your Father happy. And when you make your Father happy in heaven, you got it all. You don't have to worry about anything. In the name of Jesus, amen. If there's somebody out there that hasn't accepted Jesus and is tired and wants to give up on everything, leave a message on the internet. It's not the last time that you have to give up. We're not going to give up on you, and you're not going to give up on us. We're not going to let that happen. But if you feel like in your heart that you just want to give up, I'd like you to pray with me. If you haven't accepted Jesus and you feel like giving up, I ask you and I invite you to let Jesus into your heart, and just maybe you'll find the answer you're looking for, because I know God wants to be with you and he doesn't want you to suffer. So pray with me. Dear Lord, Father God, I ask you to touch those that are in need right now. I ask you to touch those that hunger and have no food before them. I ask you to touch those that are incarcerated in jail and feel like all is lost. And the family members that have ones that are incarcerated, and touch them. Father God, I ask you to touch all the children that are suffering, the special needs children and their family and their that take care of them, and give them faith and give them hope and give them something to strive forward and not give up. Father God, I ask you to touch all those that need you and let them know that you're here and give them the ability to say, I am not giving up. I ask you to grow their faith in you. I ask you this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Sister Willis.